Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Today, we have a very special episode of the Dr. J Show. I'm interviewing today an attorney, Ray Belair, who is representing a seminarian named Anthony Gorgia. Mr. Gorgia is suing the seminary and suing Archbishop Cardinal Dolan of New York because of the manner in which he was removed from the seminary. You see, Mr. Gorgia observed what he considered to be evidence of homosexual predation. A number of other students spoke to him about things that they had experienced. And even before he opened his mouth to anyone, he found himself excluded from the seminary. At least that's what his complaint alleges. So this case may seem like a little bit of Catholic inside baseball, but it's actually very important because what happens in a civil lawsuit of this kind could have ramifications for how the Catholic Church conducts itself, and it could have ramifications for how other organizations and religious bodies handle themselves. The fact is, lots of churches and lots of organizations have problems of sexual harassment, sexual abuse, and the accompanying cover-up. So how this case is decided could turn out to have ripple effects throughout our social system. And that's why we're interested in it here at the Dr. J Show. Stay tuned. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's episode of the Dr. J Show. My guest today is an attorney, Ray Belair, who is handling a very significant and very important, potentially very important lawsuit. So I'm going to let him tell you all about that. But in the meantime, let me just welcome Ray Belair to the Dr. J Show. Ray, thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Jennifer. It's a pleasure to finally have some interaction with you. I've read lots of what you've done over the years. They're not that many, but glad to be with you.
Well, thanks. And I appreciate what you've been doing too. So let's get right to it. Your bio and so on is going to be in the show notes. People can read about that while they're scrolling around or whatever. What we want to get to is you have filed a complaint slash lawsuit that's entitled Gorgia versus Dolan. So tell us about the plaintiff, your client, Anthony Gorgia. Who is he and exactly what is his complaint?
From his early youth on Staten Island, New York, Anthony always wanted to be a priest, and he excelled. He graduated first in his class in high school, valedictorian, first in his class in college, St. John's University. He then went on to what's called the Cathedral House of Studies. There is no degree awarded there, but it's preparation for going to the seminary in Douglaston, New York. But it's part of the Archdiocese of New York, which is headquartered in Manhattan, and he graduated from there with, again, magna cum laude grades and the hearty endorsement of the rector of that institution, Father Sears. He actively promoted Anthony, my client Anthony Gorgia, and recommended him to Timothy Dolan, the Cardinal Archbishop of New York, to be sent to the North American College in Rome, and that is what was done. But what Cardinal Dolan said to him, both in writing and in person, was, you don't have to worry about anything. You are our primary concern. We will always hold your interests above our own. You can come to us with anything. You don't have to fear anything. He incidentally received the unanimous recommendation of the faculty, including the rector, Father Harmon, Peter Harmon, who I'll get to later.
Before we go through all of the different things that led up to this, what's the complaint itself? Like right now, you're asking for something because something happened. So what is it that you're asking for? And then we'll pick up these other facts about why he's asking. Well, what's he asking for now? What's going on?
He's asking for money damages because there is no way to compel anybody to make him, well, there's no way to compel Cardinal Dolan to make him a priest. That's not an available remedy. So what are we asking? We're asking for damages to the end of his career. That has financial aspects to it. He gave up the opportunity to be a priest, or he was forced to give that up. So what are we suing for? We're suing on a number of things. Number one, New York State has its own human rights law. New York City has its own human rights law.
But hold on. My average listener may not know what happened to Anthony. So bottom line is he entered the seminary. He entered the seminary based on these promises. And then was something happened. So just let's go with what happened and then we'll pick up the other parts of it. What happened to Anthony when a stellar student with all these honors and recommendations behind him, he goes over to North American College and what happened? Why isn't he there anymore?
One day after the first semester, when not everybody was present in the refectory, which is a 50-cent word where seminarians eat, he was present, Anthony was, and another seminarian. And Father Park came in and started giving the seminarian a back massage, rubbing his shoulders and his low back and all of that. And Anthony recognized that from his earlier training as being something that can be a grooming exercise with respect to sexual, homosexual predation. And this registered, Anthony realized, his eyes didn't bug out of his head.
Right.
He didn't become an exophthalmic. But he registered surprise that he couldn't suppress, and he saw that Father Park took note of his reaction to what he was doing. Later on, the seminarian came to him and said, this has happened to me all the time with this guy, and it creeps me out, and I don't like it.
Wow.
And Anthony, later on, another seminarian came to him and said, Father Park is doing this with too many people, and he's trying to hit on me, and this is not good. Okay, now I'll fast forward. Doctors he went to in Rome, Anthony suffered from scoliosis, curvature of the spine since he was an infant, had many operations. They knew that. And he went to a surgeon and said, you have to have a surgery. I recommend you go back to New York and have it done at New York University Hospital. And he sought the permissions. He went to his spiritual advisor, Father McDonald, and said, okay, fine. Call Cardinal Dole and get his permission. I'll take care of the permissions here. Which is exactly what Anthony did. While he was back in New York recovering, he got a letter from Cardinal Dolan. 3 weeks before that, Cardinal Dolan had written him a letter congratulating him on his outstanding performance. The letter said, unfortunately, Father Harmon does not want you back.
Whoa.
So there was no reason for this. And what did Father Harmon then do over the course of back and forth what's this all about? First, he says, well, you didn't do the permissions correctly, which is like saying you crossed against the light. But he did do the permissions correctly. He went to Father McDonald. Father McDonald said, call Cardinal Dolan, et cetera, et cetera. So that wasn't correct. So then he said, well, now he's got another story, does Father Harmon. Now he says, well, there's a problem with your human formation, as you have been told, and as Father McDonald, his chief formator, said, you have problems there. In fact, in writing, Father McDonald had said, you have mastered, this is a quote virtually, you have mastered the human formation process, unquote.
Wow.
So this is all just being ginned up.
Yeah.
While he was at home, he tried many times to meet with Cardinal Dolan to present what he had. Cardinal Dolan refused him through his secretary 5 times. He refused to meet with him. So, and their secretary had one priest, it's a priest secretary, not a stenographic secretary. The priest secretary told him, it doesn't matter whether Cardinal Dolan believes you or not, he has to do what Father Harmon, the rector, wants, because he has a duty to him. Now, he doesn't have any duty to him, to Harmon, but he does have a duty to Anthony, because of what's called a fiduciary duty.
So then he goes back for a legitimate medical reason that everyone approved of and knew about. And sometime during that period of time when he was in the hospital and recovering and recuperating and so on, something happened over at the neck to where Cardinal Dolan got wind of the fact that we don't want you back. And that was being driven by Father Harmon. The official paper trail is Father Harmon said, we don't want you back. And then when Cardinal Dolan said, we don't want you back, that's the first Anthony actually knew of that?
Yes. Yeah. He was shocked, which is why he wanted and was confident that if he had an opportunity to speak to Cardinal Dolan, he could demonstrate that these claims, which were manufactured out of whole cloth, were without basis. But he was denied that that access.
I see. Okay. And so the basis of your complaint is that my client relied on promises made by Cardinal Dolan and the other people named in the complaint, which we'll mention it. We'll talk about them in a minute. But my client relied on promises made to me. And then those promises in the event were not kept. And I, on the basis of those promises, gave up other promising opportunities that I cannot easily recover now. And so that's the basis of that's the complaint. So this is a civil suit, everybody, Ruth listeners, who are not all lawyers. I know you're not all lawyers. This nobody's going to jail about this. You know, this is not that kind of a situation, but that a loss has been created. And this is a way that one seminarian is attempting to deal with a climate of what appears to be systematic homosexual predation. Is that fair? Is that a fair summary?
Yes, it is, Jennifer, but with one slight addition.
Okay.
He was told you have to go through, I'll call it a punishment detail. Oh. They didn't call it that. He had to go to St. Raymond's in the Bronx to serve in the parish for a year. The complaints that had been, the false complaints that had been generated by Harmon at the NAC would be disseminated to the entire faculty at Dunwoody, which is the Archdiocesan Seminary in New York, thereby poisoning that well. And after all of that, after a year, you'll be reevaluated, but there's no promises that you'll be back at the NAC, and there's no promises that you can continue in the Archdiocese of New York, all because of these phony claims. So under those circumstances, Anthony had no choice but to resign. Otherwise, yes, he would be complicit in these lies. And yes, that brings up the next point I wanted to add to your accurate description of what we're claiming, is that after all of that, and after he resigned from the Archdiocese of New York, he went to Bishop DiMarzio, Nicholas DiMarzio, Bishop of Brooklyn, and he met with him. He brought all of his records with him. He told Bishop DiMarzio about the, I'll call them phony, because they were, complaints about him. And Bishop DiMarzio said, I will accept you. Your record is outstanding. Your record at the NAC is outstanding. I just have to talk to Cardinal Dolan about that. You see what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So about 2 or 3 weeks later, after the first meeting, he has another meeting, and he had a sister with him as a witness. He didn't expect they'd need a witness, but this, he's been close to this woman for a long time. She's 93 right now and still going. But she goes there and he goes there. He said, listen, I'm sorry, I would take you, but Cardinal Dolan says, I shouldn't do that, and therefore I won't do that. Now, Bishop DiMarzio could have done something, because he's now, without getting too far into the weeds, Cardinal Dolan is the metropolitan for all of the dioceses in the state of New York. But each bishop is his own boss. He could do what he wants. Mm-hmm. Bishop DiMarzio was being investigated at that time by Cardinal Dolan for alleged sexual predation. That's since been found to be without basis, but that was done internally. And that's part of the problem about lack of transparency. But in any event, after the fact, that was an interference with a prospective advantage, a separate tort that Dolan committed after he betrayed his fiduciary duty, when he got in the way gratuitously of Archbishop DiMarzio's offer to take him on as a seminarian.
Okay, so let's pause before I go any further. I had some prepared questions here, but you're raising some other things in my mind. It looks to me like you mentioned the word transparency. And yes, one of the big problems that we have had, everyone who is concerned about this area of sexual harassment and sexual predation, everybody's concerned about it, is concerned about the lack of transparency. Because if you don't have honest to goodness reckoning of the facts, then everybody's left to imagine for themselves and fill in the blanks, you know, the things that are inexplicable. You just kind of naturally, your mind kind of goes different places to fill in the blanks. And so where my mind is going here is that this looks like a classic case of what has been called a homosexual network, where Father Park, now I don't know this, I can't prove it in a court of law, right? Right, Mr. Belair, I can't prove this, but it sure looks like Adam Park and the rector, and Harmon and Park and Dolan have some kind of network going on to where they have their buddies in other seminaries. They poisoned the well in another seminary. They turned the bishop of Brooklyn, did you say?
Yes.
Against him. Okay. So there's a networking going on to where you've got a whole series of decision makers who are not really independent decision makers. They appear to be, and technically on paper, they're independent decision makers. So Anthony could go from one guy to the next, but in point of fact, those doors are being closed via the network. Is that consistent with the facts as you observe them?
It is consistent. And there's an old boy network here too.
Yes.
Cardinal Dolan used to be the rector of the NAC when Father Harmon was a seminarian there. And of course that's a bishop factory. If you become the
right
director or the vice rector, you're on the road to becoming a bishop in New York. And that's where Harmon was headed. But Harmon has his own baggage too. In the Diocese of Springfield in Illinois, we submitted this in our motion. Father Harmon had baggage as well. We had witnesses that he and the then Bishop of Springfield, George Lucas, who was a friend, of course, of Cardinal Dolan, they went through the seminary in St. Louis together, were engaged in an orgy. And it's in the complaint if anybody wants to look, but there are, and the complaint describes what's going on, not in such anatomical precision that it's going to be X-rated, but you'll get the message about what Harmon and Lucas were doing. So then...
How was Dolan involved in that? I thought I heard you say Dolan was involved somehow.
Well, Dolan went through the seminary in St. Louis with Lucas. That's the connection there.
Okay,
that wasn't implying
any. He wasn't present at this orgy or whatever it was.
No. Dolan was.
Good. Okay. We're very clear about that. We don't want to throw out wrong statements. If we can possibly avoid it, we want to be careful.
But somebody else who was present, Kevin Vann, is now the Bishop of Orange in California. He went to what was going on. Go ahead.
Remind me now, who reported seeing this orgy? Because obviously the principals are not going to tell on themselves. So who saw this?
A fellow named Steve Brady from Roman Catholic Faithful.
Okay.
Which is an organization that's trying to promote orthodoxy in the Catholic Church, found a witness. He was a young Hispanic boy. He was working in the cathedral at the time. And this person told Steve Brady, the fellow's name is Munoz, Steve Munoz. He told him about what happened. He was present at the orgy, and that's where we have the information about Harmon.
I see.
Lucas,
okay.
plus Bishop Vann being a witness.
Okay.
To all of that. So, but yet with respect to transparency, what I was getting at was, for example, there wasn't any transparency here in New York. It was just okay. Well, he says that I have to do it. Back in Springfield, with respect to transparency, when this whole thing came up, Bishop Lucas, he's now the Archbishop of he's now the Bishop of Omaha or the Archbishop of Omaha. He picked one of his friends, an attorney, who is going to investigate this. The Roman Catholic Faithful sent the whole package over to the investigator, the lawyer, and he didn't even talk to the people who were involved in the orgy. He didn't talk to Munoz. He didn't talk to anybody else. And then, of course, sometime later, without ever letting anybody know that he was one of the people involved, Bishop Lucas, something is issued saying it's been investigated and there's nothing there.
Wow.
But that's opaque. That's not transparent.
Right. Wow. Yeah, there you go. So back to your complaint. On your complaint, Adam Park and Peter Harmon are named in addition to Cardinal Nolan. And then John Geary McDonald, is that the priest formator that you mentioned earlier?
Yes. He was the principal formator, and his role is to be the conduit between the seminary, and he doesn't get all the seminarians, but Anthony was one of his, and the faculty. And if there's any question, any issue, that will be reported back by Father McDonald in this case, Anthony. Nothing like that ever happened.
So the complaint is that he didn't do his duty to Anthony because he did not convey to him that there was a problem.
Right. And then when Anthony called him, he said, look, I'm going to put this in my own words, and asked for his help to confirm to Harmon that there and to Cardinal Dolan to confirm that there was no issue with my formation. You said I had mastered human formation.
Right.
And McDonald just took the company line and dummied up, didn't do anything.
Wow. He didn't okay. Report. Okay. Then there are also a number of John Does mentioned in your complaint. Who are the John Does?
Well, I could give you a more fulsome answer once we get to the discovery stage.
Okay. Very well.
But one would be, as I mentioned, one would be Father Sears, the rector of the Cathedral House of Studies, where Anthony went before he went to the NAC. And when this was going on, he was, you know, fighting for his ecclesiastical life. Anthony was. He got the psychologist at the NAC, I'm sorry, at the Cathedral House Studies at the Douglaston, to write letters to the cardinal and said, this could only have been assessed by someone who never met the man. He is the most mature, most excellent human formation. This is completely inconsistent with everything that's there and et cetera, et cetera. Father Joseph Palumbo, Dr. Joseph Palumbo, a psychologist who's there. And then Dr. Palumbo told Anthony, you know, the rector, Father Sears, he's very much in favor of you fighting this thing because it's entirely baseless. Now, fast forward to the motion where we're trying to advance and they're trying to get it dismissed. Father Sears, of course, who has to answer up the line to Cardinal Dolan, writes a letter and says, well, you know, this is a year-to-year thing. Things can change, therefore it's perfectly appropriate. Even though he was a stellar student while in his first year, this all has to be assessed. But at the time, as I say, Sears knew that the books had been cooked, and this was a phony claim. But that's part of the whole problem with lack of transparency.
Yes,
I'm sure he was pressured to do it.
Yeah.
By Dolan.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. It's another feature of the network doing its work. So now, what kind of impact is this lawsuit having around the country, around the world? I see it in the news feeds that I follow. What are you seeing? What impact is it having? Is anybody changing their behavior anywhere around the situation?
Well, this is an interesting issue. There were a number of major news outlets who were initially interested in this story. But in the end, none of them published it. Perhaps that's because we're using the sexual harassment and human rights law of saying that a heterosexual was discriminated against by homosexuals. That's not the way the wind is blowing. So that may be the reason. The other thing is it has had one effect, and you may not have caught this, but Father Park unexpectedly, a month and a half ago, unexpectedly resigned as vice rector.
I did catch that. And so what's the scuttlebutt? What's your interpretation of that fact?
Well, first of all, the North American College didn't say anything. They didn't say he did a wonderful job. They said it's just sort of effective immediately. Father Park will no longer be the vice rector. So there was a lot with him, Father Park. After Anthony was out, more people came to Anthony and said, this is, as I said before, Father Park he's much too close to a number of people at the NAC. There was one general meeting of the NAC body that Anthony was informed about after he came back to New York, where people said, well, let me ask you, Father Harmon, a hypothetical question. What about if there's a priest whose position here we will not specify, becomes too friendly with a particular seminarian, touching him, repeatedly touching him, all sorts of physical contact. What will we do about that? Well, apparently Harmon's face grew red, and he said, if that ever happens, come and tell me, and stormed out of the room.
Whoa! Little body language there, a little nonverbal cue that something's not right. Okay.
And after that, another seminarian contacted Anthony and confirmed that story and said, and said, you've got to go forward with this because there are plenty of people here who will talk, but they're afraid to because they don't want to lose their vocation formation and so forth. So, but then, okay, fine. So now we come up to 2020 and we discover that there's a former NAC seminarian who now has a big job with the University of Toronto library system. And he was in a restaurant bar in the District of Columbia. Park was ordained for the Archdiocese of Washington. And he was at the bar and Park came over to him. He started to rub his chest and rub his shoulders and rub his back. And he began to, this is Michael Casabone, he submitted an affidavit for us, said he began doing all those things. And then he began cooing and blowing in my ear. So at that point, Mr. Casabon called up, he emailed Father Harmon and said, now you got to do something about this. He's rubbing me all over my body. He's blowing in my ear in a public bar. This is unacceptable. You have to do something. Well, Harmon never responded to that. But in the passing, Mr. Casabon, who we hadn't met with him, he told us about it afterwards. Said, well, what about Anthony Gorgia? I read his story here and he's getting railroaded. On that, he said, he was a bad guy. And I'm speaking generally. That was a bad case. He just got what he deserved or something like that. Completely dismissed that and never answered the question about the complaint regarding the behavior of Father Park, who has now disappeared back to Washington. There's been no announcement about his reassignment.
So he disappeared. He removed himself. We don't really know who decided that, but what we do know is that it was fairly abrupt, and that there was no public mention or explanation of it, which is unusual when somebody is he's going on sabbatical or something like that. It doesn't sound like something else is at work there.
Yeah, if it sounds like a duck and so forth.
Yeah, that's right. So your lawsuit has already had the impact that this guy is no longer at the NAC. That's not exactly the damages you were looking for, because we don't know what's going to happen to the guy. But OK, so let's say what happens next here? Just like a lot of people, all they know about courts is what they see on TV. They see, TV trial lawyer situations kind of thing. You may or may not end up in court. Is that right? I mean, what's kind of the next step? How would this process go?
Well, we're in court to the extent that we're not at the trial yet. Uh-huh. And we filed a complaint. They answered. They didn't answer. They made a motion to dismiss.
Okay.
And their motion to dismiss was about all things in about 20,000 words. And then we responded with opposition and a cross motion to amend and to add another cause of action for breach of oral contract. And then they were supposed to respond by July 26th, and they needed more. They asked for more time. And the basis for asking for more time was that they were getting an influx, the Archdiocese of New York was, of sexual predation complaints, because the window was closing that had been opened by a former Governor Cuomo to August 16th. And they were too busy answering all of those to respond to our case. It's sort of
doesn't necessarily make them look great. But anyway, did they ever respond? So did they get the time or what?
They have until September 21st, I think it is, to respond. And then I get the final reply on my cross motion. So when it's all, that will, That's set, at least at this point, to be orally argued. Now, the judge is going to have a pile of papers this high to read. But anyway, on October 27th, I believe, that's supposed to be argued. And I don't think she's going to rule from the bench. She's going to have to write a long decision. I'd be surprised if we got a decision before the end of the year. But we might get one before the end of the year.
But the point is, you're appearing before a judge. No jury.
Right.
And the judge, the kind of decision that the judge will make, it sounds like a lady judge. She will have to decide what does she get to decide?
What she gets to decide is we have 12 causes of action.
Okay.
A couple of them, for technical reasons, I withdrew because we had to go through a preliminary thing that we didn't do. But most of them are surviving. She has to go through there And the burden for the defendants is to say that, well, even if we take everything here as true, it doesn't result in a cause of action. And okay. We reply, oh, you're wrong, because the cases say this, that, and the other. That's in a nutshell what her job is to weed through all of this and make decisions on a case by claim by claim basis of all of the claims that are within the case.
I see. And so she has the right to say all 12 of them are founded, or none of them are founded, or anything in between. She can do that.
Right.
Okay. And at that stage, does she decide damages, or is that a separate hearing?
No, all that does means that they have to now file an answer.
They move for answer.
And then once you have an answer, then you have a discovery schedule. And the discovery schedule, you know, could take 6 months. This is fairly, I don't know, New York is not draconian. But, you know, if we got an answer by the first of the year, something like that, there might be, the judge might say, all right, well, do all of these things by 60 days. That might be extended a little bit. It's hard to say, 4 to 6 months, something like that,
okay,
to end discovery. And then they may well try what's called a motion for summary judgment, where they will say, well, there's no genuine issue of material fact. Here's all the depositions we took. Here are all the affidavits. Here's this. And then we go through the same exercise, although on a slightly different basis. And in that issue, in that case, if there is any genuine issue of material fact after the judge looks at that potential motion, then and in that case, we would go on to trial.
I see. And at any stage along here, the Archdiocese could, if they chose, this is a question, I shouldn't state it as a statement, but could they, if they chose, offer to pay you something to make this all go away?
Yes.
In other words, to settle out of court, could they offer to do something like that?
Sure. But, you know, the race is not always to the fast or the battle to the strong, but it's still the way to bet. Jean Gomolka, who I referred you to with respect to some other articles here.
Yes.
He's a resource. He submitted an affidavit. He's a former teacher at a major seminary. And what he told me was Cardinal Dolan would sell St. Patrick's Cathedral before he'd ever allow himself to be put under oath and answer questions. So until we get to the point where something like that is about to happen or has happened, I don't expect there to be any offer.
Frankly, I
don't expect there to be any offer at all. But Jean Gomolka has a better insight on that. Maybe he's right. Maybe he would sell St. Patrick's Cathedral before he let himself be questioned under oath. I don't know.
Yes. But in the way this type of case goes, that's kind of always out there as an option to make it go away.
As a matter of fact, if we didn't do anything, the judge would say, let's have a settlement conference, fellas.
Gotcha.
And ladies.
Gotcha. Yeah. So in the period leading up to this, problems, what do you call it? These losses have already been inflicted on Anthony.
Right.
Is there anything that you would want the seminary to do that the seminary could do in addition to monetary damages that would be satisfactory to Anthony? Or does is only money the only thing involved? Or could there be, well, like if they fired somebody or changed something, would that be a factor in his thinking?
He's not out for revenge. Mm-hmm. He wants a finding that he was blameless. He wants a finding that what these people did was wrong. And he wants that not just for his own name being cleared so he can go on with his life, but he wants to do it so that this doesn't happen to other seminarians. And this is a big problem. A couple of months ago, everybody else was in person. We were on by Zoom or whatever with seminarians who had gotten what I call a raw deal. Maybe 8 or 9 of them, plus Anthony and I by Zoom, talking about all the things that had been visited upon seminarians, not exactly the same as Anthony's. Everybody had a slightly different story, but it had to do with one aspect or another of homosexuality being promoted, endorsed, covered up, et cetera, and anybody who said anything about it was given this is a well-known legal term, the bum's rush.
And shown
the door or the sort of punitive action that was being taken against Anthony. But what he wants to do is a declaration that what they did was wrong and that what he got was the dirty end of the stick completely without any basis. That's what he wants.
He wants his reputation restored, and he wants them to admit that they did something wrong. And this lawsuit is a vehicle for accomplishing that.
Honestly, it is.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, and since you said that, you offered in one of the things that you said an opportunity to say what your viewers and listeners could do. We're up against firms that are very well staffed, lots of lawyers, and they're billing probably up to $1,000 an hour. Anthony isn't getting bills like that, but his resources are very limited. He has a GoFundMe page. It's GoFundMe Save Our Seminarians. GoFundMe Save Our Seminarians, where if anybody would like to contribute whatever they think is appropriate, they could do that online.
Well, that would be terrific. And let me ask you this question. You mentioned these attorneys that you're confronting. Who's paying them?
The Archdiocese of New York and the North American College, which is an organ of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops. So they have plenty of money for that sort of thing.
So another thing people could potentially do, if you live in New York, you should write to Cardinal Dolan that you don't care for your donations being spent in this manner, you know, the resources that belong to the faithful that have been entrusted to the church there. And anyone anywhere could say something to the bishops' conference about, you know, really, guys, are you really defending this guy? You know, why don't you let them twist in the wind, guys? Or why don't you do something at the neck? Which brings me to my next question.
Before you ask me that, Jennifer,
could
I make you a consultant to my firm? You have excellent ideas.
Sure, anytime. Let's strategize.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, in previous rounds of clergy sex abuse scandals and crises, a lot of times people who were faithful to the Catholic magisterium kind of kept their heads down because they thought, well, we love Pope John Paul II and we don't want anything bad to happen to him and so on and so forth. Well, now the whole ecclesial deck has been shuffled. And now it's the people who are the most faithful to Catholic teaching, most faithful to the magisterium and the ancient traditions of the church. Those are the ones who are saying, look, we got to clean house here. We got to get something done here. And your dissenters are, you know, kind of a little nervous about coming out of the woodwork and trying to figure out whose side they're on, I think, would be a way to put it. But let me ask you this. Let's say you had your best day in court and the judge gave you guys everything you wanted. Obviously what Mr. Gorgia would receive would be the monetary damages that you've already mentioned. You get that and probably court costs and that kind of stuff. Is there something else you guys would want to see happen as part of the resolution of this case?
Well, legally speaking, there are things that are called equitable remedies where somebody is directed to do something. There's no remedy that's equitable that's available in a case like this. It's solely money damages. But on the other hand, what I will refer to as Orthodox Catholics. What's an Orthodox Catholic? It's someone who embraces the ancient dogma and doctrine and tradition of the church. And what's the opposite of an Orthodox Catholic? Joe Biden. As an example. Or John Kerry when he ran for president. And before we forget, the Springfield Diocese, Bishop Paprocki, to his credit, had a discussion with Senator Dick Durbin, the number two in the Democratic Senate, and said, until you change your mind and publicly recant your support for abortion, do not present yourself for Holy Communion in the Diocese of Springfield.
That's right.
To his credit. But there are very few. There are very few people like that. Very few.
That's right. So there's no equitable relief. I'm aware of one case, for example, where the diocese decided to settle with the family because they realized that the priest that they were trying to defend, the priest was indefensible. And so they settled with the family. And one of the things the family asked for was a public apology to clear their son's name. So is that something that could potentially be in the mix? For a settlement.
There wouldn't be any prohibition on that. Certainly, you can say something like that. That happens in a number of cases across the board. there has to be something tangible, which means the only thing that's tangible is money. But they would also ask for something like what you just described. That would be wonderful if we could do it. But we live in hope and die in despair.
Sure.
It might happen, but it's not the way to bet.
Sure. So let's follow your lawsuit through the different tentacles of the lawsuit. Okay. So the people who are named in the complaint are Archbishop or Cardinal Dolan and the seminary, the immediate people there at the seminary. Those are the people named in the complaint. Is anybody else? So this money damage, it comes out that if you, let's say you win, somebody's going to pay damages. That's going to come from whom? Their private pocket? That's going to come from the seminary itself? Where's that? Who's on the hook for that money?
The Archdiocese of New York, at least for the time being, they haven't filed for bankruptcy, although Rockville Center nearby has. Mm-hmm. They have deep pockets. So if Cardinal Dolan is found to have done something wrong, I'm sure the Archdiocese in New York will have to pay for that, or will pay for that, because they'd also be liable for his actions under the rules of vicarious liability. And the North American College, they're liable for the acts of the people that I mentioned, McDonald, Harmon.
But the point is, the individuals are not going to be liable. So what about the people who would be... The people who are on the, presumably there's like a board of governors of the North American College. Liable in some way?
They're not liable. This is what's called a corporate veil.
Okay.
They're not individually liable, but the organization is.
Okay.
But the other people, there would be a judgment, if everything is established, against McDonald, Harmon, Park, and the North American College. That's called joint and several liability. Who pays it is their problem.
So what do you think is going to be the long-term impact of this whole process on the seminary itself? I mean, I'm just looking down the road a little bit. Father Park has disappeared. That's probably a good thing. But the network, the rest of the network, is probably still there. What do you hope would happen? What do you think might happen?
If we're successful, that would force the media, which is averse to Orthodox Catholics, to report it. They couldn't ignore it then.
Yeah.
And once something becomes public, then, you know, there are situations where people have voted with their feet. And once enough people get riled up, they'll say, we want this to change, and we're not going to allow this to go on unless and until you do something that's transparent, and we're going to withhold our contributions. Now, that's something that any bishop or archbishop or the USCCB should be listening to, because of course they rely very heavily on their donations. Father Harmon is always touring the United States, visiting donors and currying favor to get that sort of thing. But if they don't, and there's already been some reluctance, I see it anecdotally, that people have said, I used to contribute to the North American College, but I'm not doing it. There's no groundswell, because except for, you know, wonderful people like you and other people, that I'll call you Orthodox Catholic media. If you don't like that, I'll change it. But that's my view.
Yeah.
Then it has to be made more publicly available, because not everybody will get it. Once that happens, you could see change. But until that happens, it's going to continue to be opaque, the opposite of transparency.
Yeah. And, you know, I have the sense throughout this whole crisis of clergy sex abuse and the homosexual networks and their influence and so on, I have the sense that if you just could get a critical mass of people who would do the kind of thing that Mr. Gorsh is doing, and the kind of thing that, you know, you need a critical mass of whistleblowers. You need a critical mass of people who put their foot down. And then the dam will break, and a lot of people will be coming forward and going, oh my gosh, I'm so relieved that you did that. And is he just off? Well, we're on the record, so I can't say off the record, but are you in a position to tell me, has he been receiving comments from other people who have been at the NAC in past years and things like that? Are people contacting him to encourage him and tell him to keep going?
To a certain extent, yes. He actually got an indirect letter encouraging him, that the origin of which is said to have come from Archbishop Vigano, and you know who he is, yeah.
Of course,
but also from people who have gone through the NAC, and they have indicated to him that we're rooting for you, this has to stop, and so forth. The problem is they've moved on to positions depending upon what diocese or archdiocese they've been ordained for, where they have to, and this is, I'm not going to go into cases because they're vulnerable, where they are fearful that if they came forward, that their position would be in jeopardy. For example, a good friend of mine, a priest, told me that a priest in New York, who I will not mention his name, obviously, said that the deal around here is if you get out of line, you'll get sent to the St. Luke's Institute or someplace where they say he has psychiatric problems. And you got to go down there and find out what's going on. In New York, this priest calls it Gulag Dolan, where you're sent to the Gulag for evaluation for being whatever. There's something dysmorphic in your personality. You have to change your ways. It's a detention center, punitive in nature, where you either decide to toe the line or get out, which is essentially what they did to Anthony.
Yes, yes. And we hear these stories. We have no way of knowing how many such stories there are and how true they are. You know, one thing that other bishops could do is to stop sending their men to the NAC. I mean, you might think, I mean, I don't know. I don't know how these kind of networks work or what kind of pressures the bishops are under to conform in different ways. But, you know, a few bishops saying, we don't need to send our guys there. We can send our guys someplace else. I don't know.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. There are all sorts of options for where you want to, where you can send people. You know, there are no places overcrowded with vocations these days. That's another problem.
Right,
but there are places that you could go that aren't necessarily the NAC, which used to be, you know, where the cream of the it's still that where the cream of the cream from college was sent to seminary. That's still there, but they'd have to change. But there are all sorts of other places where you could be sent. And not all of them are just for that diocese. There are plenty of people. There are plenty of people elsewhere. I went to just as an example. I went to my wife's mother's funeral last week, up in Boston, and a priest came to preside at the graveside, and he announced at the beginning, "I was ordained by Cardinal O'Malley 3 months ago," and then he proceeded. So I caught him on the way out. And after giving him an emolument, I said, "Were you ordained for Boston?" He said, No. I have a 10-year commitment in Boston, and then I can go to back home to India." But there are plenty of places that people can go. Every bishop has the right to say, "I accept you."
Yes.
And there are some good ones. I just made a couple of notes. You talked about the 30 bishops, and as I indicated to you, I don't know a lot about all of them, but I do know about some of the good ones. There's a picture there of Bishop Aquila, Archbishop Aquila from Denver. He's very good. He's very orthodox. Something I didn't mention up until now is that Anthony and Monsignor Gomulka have been writing to every bishop in the United States, every head of every dicastery in the in Rome, congregation for clergy, congregation for bishops, all that stuff, all across America, and only two passed it on to Rome: Cardinal O'Malley in Boston and Bishop Edgar de Cunha, the Bishop of Fall River, my original. I grew up in the Fall River Diocese. They passed it on to Rome.
And what was the letter? What was the letter that they've been writing to these bishops?
Complaining about the treatment that Anthony received, and asking them to do something about it.
I see.
We didn't get any response except what I just indicated. So that's why we went to court.
I see. So this was a while ago that you did that. You took that step and hoped somebody would react. Yeah.
Anthony started it before he came to me, writing to all these people. Then there was a second wave. But, you know, like the Corinthians or the Thessalonians, they don't write back. Like the Thessalonians, they don't write back, I should say.
Yeah, yes. You know, one other thing that puzzles me about this, and I would like your speculation about this. Maybe you are not in a position to know this, but if a man is at the North American College, is it possible to go through the North American College and not know that there's a problem of homosexual predation?
Well, I see there's something I left out here, and it's in the complaint that Father Park and probably the other people who do this, they pick a certain type of individual, usually the very young, usually very good looking, usually naive, and usually somewhat athletic, and this is the way they proceed against that kind of person who's more likely to be, because grooming is something, as you know, Jennifer, grooming is something where these people induce a sense of confidence and trust before they get onto more disgusting things. But as long as that's there, it won't be everybody, but it should be enough that word gets around. And certainly when that seminarian told the story about the questioning when Harmon came out with a red face, and that there are people here who are dying to come forward. And if they were, and basically what they were saying is, if you give us a subpoena, we'll come. But to come out even after you're home and safe and you made it through and you're unscathed, so to speak, they're afraid to pop their heads up unless you do compel them to. And then they can say to the bishop, what can I do? I've been subpoenaed. I have to tell the truth.
Right.
These
guys are sneaky too. The fact that Park was monitoring Anthony's reaction, you know, he's looking around. And one thing I read something recently, their antenna get up. And one thing I read recently, this is by Father Kulchik. This was a published article that Father Kulchik published. And this is the priest who got booted out by Cardinal Supich over the burning of a rainbow flag in his parish. And this priest has essentially been in hiding for a while. Anyway, he wrote this very revealing article where he looked back on the early days of his priesthood and noticed that people, he didn't realize it at the time, but they were checking him out to see if he was, available. And he was like, I went right by him and he didn't respond. And so, nothing ever happened. But looking back on it, he can see, that was really odd that I was alone with that guy and that people were asking me these types of questions, talking about these topics in front of me. That was kind of odd. And looking back on it, now he sees it. And there may be people who have been through the North American College who, looking back on it, can go, maybe that is what was going on. I didn't realize it at the time, but maybe that's what was happening.
Yes, I've seen those things too, where they say that, when they know that Father so and so is thus and so, he sort of. I wonder what he was up to. Was he trying exactly what you're saying?
Yeah.
But there's another aspect of that where Anthony's concerned. Yes, he saw Father Park. And then shortly thereafter, the guy came up to him. But the rest of the stuff with the meeting where someone's crying out for help and Harmon's storming off, that's much later. When he was there, he didn't realize, except for those two things that I mentioned, he didn't realize how pervasive this stuff is. And it goes back even to when Park was in the seminary at the North American College. Somebody learned about his proclivities and shoved a picture under the door of a good-looking male flight attendant. And one thing led to another, and nothing was done about Park, but the two people who shoved that under the door were thrown out of the North American College. So, what am I saying? It pops up every once in a while. Presumably it'll pop up less frequently at the NAC to the extent that Park isn't there anymore, but I don't think it's eradicating the problem.
Right.
You know, there's some, There are people everywhere. There's a very good book. It's been out for quite a while now, called Goodbye, Good Men by Michael Rose. You know
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
And one thing after, and all of the techniques, all of the tactics, all of the awful stuff. And not only that, in some instances, they're teaching such junk
yeah.
that these seminarians have to get together at night secretly and study Orthodox Catholicism.
That's right.
That's a whole other problem.
That's right. And honestly, that's how we got involved in a way. Was it in our defense of traditional Christian sexual ethics, we could see, well, why isn't the Catholic Church doing its part to teach this stuff? I mean, it's our stuff. Everybody else is borrowing our stuff. Why aren't they using it? Well, it's because we have too many queers in the clergy. You know, it's just as simple as that. So, you know, Mr. Belair, it has really been a pleasure talking with you and getting to know you better. Could you tell us once again how people can help Anthony, your client, in his effort to clean out the North American College? If only by this one action, there's probably other things that need to be done, but he's at least doing his part. How can people help him do his part to clean the seminary?
Well, once again, thank you, Jennifer. We're up against very well-funded opponents who have waves and waves of attorneys who are fighting this. I'm doing this essentially by myself, but it all costs money. So with respect to the other people I get involved, they have to be compensated. The place is gofundme.com, save our seminarians. That's it. Gofundme.com, save our seminarians. Anything that you contribute, we have very small contributions. We have a couple of four-figure contributions. We need more. We're going to run into problems, and anything that your listeners can do would be greatly appreciated, no matter what it is.
And the other thing that people should know about is that the Ruth Institute sponsors a Facebook group that's called Catholic Activists United. And Catholic Activists United often gets involved in letter writing campaigns and things of that sort. So we'll be posting information about Anthony's case on that Facebook group. And so you can go there and get more information about who you might write to, what you might say, get accurate facts before you write your letter, before you sit down and write your letter. You want to know what you're talking about. And so those are two ways you can be involved, both in a financial way and in an activist way. Ray Belair, thank you so much for being my guest today on the Dr. J Show. It's really been helpful.
It's been a pleasure, Jennifer. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you.